the right side.
This is...
He just drills a three right in his mug.
The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Pops it up for Porzingis.
With Chris Casper and Jim Murray. Brought to you by Shaw's and Star Market, Bentley University, Direct Federal Credit Union, and Jack's Abbey on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Fans are reacting as Kristaps Porzingis is going to return nearly 5 minutes into the game to replace Al Horford, the exact spot that Al has been replacing him all year. Porzingis trying to pivot a little bit, turns the corner. He's got a lane to the basket. He flies in and slams it with two hands.
Wow.
Looks pretty healthy now. 26-18, Boston by 8. Surprising how quickly he beat Lively to the rim. Boston by 14. Kyrie forces one up, blocked by Porzingis again. Floats it out to Pritchard on the left wing. Pritchard shovel back to Porzingis. How about a trail three? Got it!
Oh, that's some good stuff here, man.
Pump fake. Porzingis steps to the top of the circle and hits again. 40 days and 40 nights he spent away from the Celtics. He's been back on the floor for 10 minutes. He's got 15 points. Porzingis catch, deep three, got it. Are you serious with this return for Porzingis? 7 of 9, 2 of 3 from distance, 18 points in 11 minutes, and the Celtics lead by 28.
And welcome to the Sports Hub Celtics Show with your Boston Celtics set 1-0 on the Dallas Mavericks in the NBA Finals. As the guys in green make their playoff run, Dedham Savings here for the journey. Yours too. Go to DedhamSavings.com. Member FDIC, member DIF. All right, Kristaps Porzingis is easily the story coming out of the Game 1 win. 20 points, ridiculous first half after he has this triumphant return from a calf injury. Didn't play for a month. He sounded like he was unsure of himself at the podium earlier in the week, NBA Media Day. I can't help it. I go through life as an eternal pessimist. Just my nature. I heard how he sounded. I said, this guy's not going to be right. Stephen A. Smith was of ESPN was taking the Dallas Mavericks in this series because he felt that, Kristaps Porzingis wasn't going to be moving right. He's not right. I think he's as plugged in as anybody is in the league. I felt like hearing him, I was like, well, he's heard something. Porzingis isn't going to be right. Those two things combined, how Porzingis carried himself at the podium, Stephen A. taking the Mavs and talking about Porzingis, I said, he ain't going to be right. And then he doesn't even... He comes out late. He's not part of the starting lineup. I was like, oh, boy. And then he goes bananas. And that might have been one of my favorite Grandy calls ever, by the way, when he says, are you kidding me? Like, that was genuine as genuine gets. Because collectively, I think everyone in the building, everyone watching at home, everyone watching around the world, just that's the thing you say. Are you kidding me? He was explosive going to the rim. The shots couldn't have been any more pure. If he's going to look like this, I'd like the Celtics in six. I think we collectively all said that a few days ago or, going into game one. If it's going to look like this and the Mavs aren't going to look like they have a third option and Kyrie's not going to play as poorly as he did, if he's going to do that, this will be over in four or five.
Yeah, I'd say if he's going to play like that, Celtics in three, right?
Yeah, right.
No, he was tremendous. And for me, the offense obviously stands out when you miss that much time. But what I liked even more than that was the defense. His ability to block shots, get back on defense, block that Josh Green dunk attempt. And it wasn't just the shot blocks that he had, and he finished with three of them. It was the shots that he altered, that he deterred by just being there. You know, Dallas is a team that coming into the game was number one in the NBA in terms of shot attempts in the paint outside of the restricted area, so outside of that little, dotted line, the little smiley face, they were number one in the playoffs of the remaining teams, of any team that went outside of the first round in those attempts at 18.7. And he was a big part of deterring them from taking those shots and also from making those type of shots. They were just 7-22, 31%. On those shots in the game. And I thought Porzingis was a huge, huge part of that. So as much as we fixate and focus on the offense, and hey, we should, guys hitting 30-foot threes, I thought his defense really changed the game and played a big part in Dallas struggling to get offensive traction.
No, it was end-to-end dominance at the end of the first. I mean, it was mind-blowing. It was awesome to watch. And he's easy, there is like this Euro charm to the whole thing. Like,
yeah.
And like a sly smile that he
has.
The
wink.
Like,
he had the wink, which was cool.
Yeah, it was genuinely great to see. And so, B-Rob, again, you're around the team. You're covering the team. I think you also kind of, mirrored my nervousness after hearing him and seeing him at the podium. We didn't know what the hell we were going to get. You too must have been like, you know, yeah, I get it. You're covering the team. You're supposed to have an even keel, but you must have been like, well, this is awesome.
It was insane. Yeah. It was like one of the best, I think one of his best halves of the entire season. And for him to come back like that on that type of a stage was incredible, because defensively is what I was really, as Chris pointed out, like that's the area where you think, oh, if he's not right, the Mavericks could really go after him there. But he was the rim protector they've been kind of lacking at points during the last couple rounds. And for him to do that and just stay steady with when he got switched on to Luka in those chances, that was huge. And so my question for you guys now, with him looking this good, do you, even though obviously you won, do you just say, okay, we saw what we needed to see, you're back in the starting five, Al back to the bench, or do you wait until, you know, maybe they lose a game to think about something like that?
Yeah, I mean, there is part of me that's like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And if it's going to be part of like a bit of a, even though Joe Mazzulla going into game one said like there is no minutes restriction, it's clear that there was a bit of one. He wasn't in the starting lineup. I think for game two, I wouldn't mess with it.
That's a great question. I mean, the tempting thing obviously is, hey, just let it go. Just, you know, keep going with it. But I also look at it and say, okay, he came in and changed the game. And not that he's going to do that every time, but would you have had that explosion earlier if he had started the game, I guess is my question. So for me, that's the role he played most of the year. I probably would put him back in the starting lineup. Again, mainly for the defense. Offensively, I don't think it makes a difference, but defensively it made a difference. And if I don't want the Mavericks to get any traction at the beginning or any confidence at the beginning of game two, I would switch it up and put him back in the starting lineup.
Now, he did cool in the second half. Credit to the Dallas Mavericks for figuring out something defensively there, Brian.
Yeah, I think they tried to switch less on him so he could, you know, couldn't camp out as much at the free throw line when he was automatic at that point there. But honestly, I think just like the Celtics offense just wasn't as good for a lot of the third quarter until Jaylen Brown got going with that run to close out the third. So I think that was more of a team-wide thing than a Porzingis thing. But he's a kind of a streaky player throughout his tenure here where he's just going to have those stints. And as long as you get that out of him at some point in the game, then, you know, the Celtics will take it because they don't need that from him for 30 minutes anyway.
Let's go to Tommy and Lynn. What'd you make of game one there, Tommy?
Hey, what's up, guys? I was excited for game one. Porzingis makes the factor for them to win the championship. He had a big game one. This has to happen again. I was happy that Kyrie Irving and Luka weren't doing anything really. Kyrie Irving, he can't take the pressure. He can't take the heat. This series is going to be over in five. Celtics in five. And Murray, you brought them good luck. Murray, are you going again tomorrow night now? Because if you are, you got to keep going because you bring them good luck. You're the good luck job.
Yeah, well, no, the Murray the Mush factor actually didn't factor in, thankfully. But no, that's the one and only. Everything else has to go to the clients at this point. So
You're good luck, though. It's like, you know, they should superimpose your face over Lucky the Leprechaun. That would be cool, because then when Kyrie stomps on it again, it's your face.
Many people, what a pickle many people would be in, because they're like, oh, I hate him, but I also hate him too. And I want you to stomp on that face.
You're beloved, man. You're beloved.
One thing I I disagree with one thing Tommy said, and I've heard this even from one of my buddies, like, yeah, there was a suck night for Luka too. No, it wasn't. And it was a quiet 30.
Yeah.
And you could tell conditioning was a factor, or his knee.
They went after him.
If he didn't have the 30 he had, well, they lose by like 50. Like, he's the only reason the Mavs were kind of in this. He willed them back into it in the third quarter. I don't think it was a bad night for Luka.
I don't think it was a bad night. I think
wasn't great.
Yeah, I think he can play better. But again, I just think, that's one of those. I put the bad night for Luka is in the same as the halftime show showed an anti-Boston bias. It's like, you know, you're really letting your fan freak flag fly there when you say that. Like, your bias is just clouding you. It wasn't a bad night for him. And if you're being honest with yourself, when he drained that ridiculously long three and was barking at the crowd, you were nervous.
Oh, yeah. You were
nervous that he was about to take over the game. And he may have if Derek Lively didn't. I don't know what happened there. He just, like, spazzed out after he grabbed that rebound and traveled. And then it goes back to the Celtics. And so my point on that is, like, Luka never – down eight – Luka never even like got a chance to potentially
put you
in a bad situation because you had the Lively travel. So you dodged a little bit of a bullet there. I wouldn't say he had a bad night, but I would also say the Celtics did an excellent job of making him try and play defense. I thought Jaylen Brown went after him. I thought Tatum went after him. And that's what you knew they were going to do and what they wanted to do when that was there. Jaylen Brown was 3 for 3 when he went at Luka. And Luka had a hard time staying in front of him or keeping him in front of him. And that's what you have to do. You have to make him play both ends. And you have to attack him on the defensive end. I thought the Celtics did a great job of that. And they should keep that up. Don't let him rest on defense. Make him defend one of your better players. Dallas did. I saw this, you know, online. Dallas did sometimes use him as kind of like a roaming help defender, I think, to give him a break. And there were times he was on like Derek White in a corner and he'd just leave him, or on Holiday in a corner and just leave him. So I think that's kind of Dallas's answer, is we'll buy Luka a little bit of breathing room and breathing time on defense. But the Celtics should take advantage of that too.
Yeah, right about that a little bit on Mass Life, Chris. And he instinctually, just keep an eye on him, like he's a poor decision maker defensively.
He is.
He makes bad, like, okay, yeah. I'm gonna randomly double this guy right now. Like, well, you can't really do that because when you have 5 3-point shooters on the floor for Celtics. So I do wonder, like, heading into game two, do they clean that up for him? Does he get more solid with stuff like that, or are the Celtics still going to be picking at it?
I think he hunts steals, which means he ends up hunting the ball, which is not always sound, fundamental, good team defense.
617-779-0985 is the phone number. You want to join us and give us some of your leftover thoughts of the game one win for the Celtics as they're up 1-0 on the Dallas Mavericks as we get ready for game two tomorrow night with an 8 p.m. tip at TD Garden. We'll get to more of your calls and thoughts coming up next in the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
We'll have more of the Sports Hub Celtics Show next. Sub. The Boston Celtics play here.
For a 50 piece.
This is the Sports Hub Celtics Show on the Sports Hub.
Looks like heat check time for Doncic. Getting in his back. Oh!
By the shoot. Doncic behind the back. Here's the blow by. The floater. It's good.
Missed it.
Oh! A grown man's jam on the follow.
Into the backcourt. He'll pick it up. 6 seconds. 5 seconds. It's going to take some Luka magic to save the possession. And that's what it is!
His name is Luka.
Luka's fat. Look at him. The guy's a whale.
He can barely run the floor.
He's out of shape.
He's portly and has man boobs. Yeah, you know that. You've seen him before.
He's a fat slob.
And he's got quite an appetite. Yeah, I bet he's covered in cellulite. The Celts ain't losing to this chunk. The Celts ain't losing to this chunk. The Celts ain't losing to this chunk.
Luka's a fat slob.
Conditioning was a factor. Sports of Celtics Show. And the knee, too. And look, the Mavs and Doncic, they're not a particularly like high assist team, Chris and B-Rob, but they finish with more turnovers than assists. And if you're a Mavs fan, you're going to be watching that and saying, well, if this is what it's going to be, another factor as to why we're not going to have any chance against the Celtics in this team. And there are other factors, too. Obviously, Kyrie Irving has to be a lot better. We'll get to that. But again, the lack of facilitating from Luka Doncic, I think, was also a factor of them losing this game.
I just sort of disagree with the premise of that. Like, I think he did facilitate. Guys didn't make shots.
Yeah, okay.
That 41 passes. I mean, to me, I watched it look like a pretty normal Luka game. I could be wrong. Maybe B-Rob has a different thought. But, I mean, he threw 41 passes and got one assist. I believe the Celtics love this stat, too, and someone sent this to me online. I believe that the, what's it, potential assist or whatever, it was like he should have had 7. And frankly, I feel like even that number's low because that's based off guys missing shots. I thought there were a couple of passes he made. I know at least one to Lively where it's like the guy fumbled the pass, and if he doesn't fumble it, he's going to have a shot attempt that's makeable. So I thought he facilitated. I just thought those guys didn't knock down shots. Now, I also give the Celtics credit for that because they took away the shots those guys – like, you didn't get the open lobs at the rim for Lively and Gafford, and they really forced them out of their comfort zone on the threes. As I mentioned yesterday on Felger and Maz Gym, the Mavericks during the regular season led the NBA in corner three-point attempts per game at 11.3, and a lot of that is Luka, and they're at 11.2 in the playoffs. The only team averaging more in the playoffs is New Orleans, and they didn't get beyond the first round. The Celtics only surrendered 3 of those corner threes in game one, and that was one of the threes that was made by Dallas. They were 1-for-3. Dallas was 6-for-24 in the above-the-break threes, which is not a shot their guys like or are comfortable with. And out of those, it's like Luka made 4 of those. So I think that the Celtics did a good job of taking away what the role players are, the shots they're comfortable making. And so those guys didn't make the other shot. So then Luka has the one assist.
Yeah, that was a game where the Celtics decided, like, we're going to stay home most of the time and we're going to take our chance with Luka. We're going to make Luka beat us. And getting to 30 points by needing 26 shot attempts to do it, the Celtics will take that every day of the week in this series because the Mavericks just don't have enough offense around Luka to, you know, make up the rest of it there if he's not scoring at a very efficient level. So as we wear on here, maybe Luka gets more aggressive in attacking it. If, like, okay, you're going to put Al Horford on me, you're going to put Porzingis on me, I'm going to take these guys to the hoop, I'm going to get them in foul trouble, try to punish them that way to put the pressure on the Celtics. But otherwise, I don't change anything if I'm Joe Mazzulla in game 2, because that game plan worked as well as you could hope for.
Well, Al, you know, speaking of Al, Al was fantastic. Forsberg posted this yesterday. When Al Horford was the primary defender on Luka, Luka was 1-of-8, 0-of-4 from 3. He got one shot blocked. He had 3 points. And overall, the Mavs were 5-for-19 versus Horford when he was the primary defender. So Al's defense, as much as we talked about Porzingis' defense and the rim protection, Al's defense was outstanding too and had a big part in containing Luka Doncic.
Is it just as simple as he's benefiting from this long layoff and the time off at 38 years old?
I think it's that. I think it's also he's benefiting from the way he was used most of the year. I'd have to go back and look at the minutes. I know he didn't play back-to-backs last year, but then he had to defend Embiid in the second round. I thought that really wore him out. I also have a sense of maybe Al's kind of like a marathon runner who is sensing the finish line here and that they can, you know, they can win. He tied John Stockton for the most playoff games played without winning a ring by playing in game 1. Only Malone's ahead of him. He's not going to catch up to Malone. I'm sure he doesn't want to catch up to Malone here. I think he smells it.
I also think Al, the fact that Luka is not super fast compared to the guys Al has seen the last couple rounds. He's not Donovan Mitchell with the ball. Even like a Garland, even like Nembhard, the guys of the Pacers, those guys were lightning quick. And Luka is clearly a superstar, but he does it at his own pace. And Al can handle it from a defensive standpoint, the mobility wise there. And we saw him do it well. He got a couple like nice blocks and just a bunch of good contests throughout that game.
Marcus in the car with a thought on Luka Doncic. Hey, Marcus.
Hey, what's up, guys? Man, great show. Love listening to y'all every weekend.
Appreciate it.
And that piece, the song you guys just did there about Luka was pretty amazing, which leads me to my story. A buddy of mine who manages a pretty high-end restaurant in the city, and Luka and a couple of teammates apparently did attend last night and was really disappointed to hear that upon his exit of the restaurant, he was getting heckled. He was getting heckled by Celtics fans saying, you know, yelling Celtics in 5, you know, some other things that I'm not able to say on the radio. But thought that was a little classist, especially at a high-end restaurant, right? I might expect that at the 99 or something, but not at the restaurant, which I'm not going to say.
Yeah, that's good.
But, you know, pretty interesting stuff around how you're getting treated in these few days in the city.
Yeah, I don't like hearing that. I mean, look, you want to...
You want to joke with them and jab them.
Yeah, you want to bust.
That's fine. But if you're saying there's stuff you can't say on the air that was said to, now I'm kind of curious.
If you want to bust balls and you know, heckle in the stadium, that's one thing.
If you want to do a parody song about how fat he is while he's eating, like, that's one thing. But this is you know, beyond the pale.
High-end restaurant, too. You expect a little better, a little higher class clientele, too, that aren't going to be like, yeah, you suck, Luka. How many carbs did you ingest tonight, huh? Did you get double mashed? I bet you did. Don and Carver next year in Sports Up Celtics Show. Go ahead, Don. Hello.
Summertime and the tissues are flimsy.
What do you got, Don?
That's for you, Jim, from the beginning of the show. I hear you with the flimsy tissue.
Oh, yes. Oh,
listen. Yeah. I'm glad I explained it then. That would have seemed odd. My call has to do with the maturation of Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum going, bullying their way into the circle and going to the basket, especially Jaylen Brown. It's amazing how this guy has matured and has taken it to the basket time and again. And he's incredibly cut his figure. He takes care of himself. Jason put on that weight and muscle in the off season also, and the two of them, that option for both of them when they were primarily, maybe not primarily, but known as 3-point shooters. They didn't go to the basket all that much the first couple of years, but they certainly are doing it now. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Don. That's a good point by Don in terms of Jaylen Brown knowing his, as much as we talk about this team is successful because they shoot threes, and obviously they're a fantastic 3-point shooting team, and we know how Mazzulla feels about 3-point attempt rate. For me, that's a little chicken and the egg. Like, I look at that and say, okay, if you took a baseline team and they attempted more threes than a really great team like the Celtics, does that mean they're going to win? I'd say no. I think the reason the Celtics can win attempting this many threes is because they have a great team. I don't think they have a great team because they attempt this many threes, if you get what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But I do think it makes sense for Jaylen Brown being able to be the guy that doesn't take a ton of threes and that gets into the lane. And he really just plays with a lot of, as Scal would say, force and strength, and he's able to bully and get to the rim. The other thing I'll say quickly about Jaylen, I don't think we talk enough about his defense the other night. You know, pick Luka's pocket, 3 steals, 3 blocks. Yes, there's still times I think he makes like a lackadaisical defensive decision, but his defense has been really good throughout the playoffs. I think it's basically the reason he won the Eastern Conference Finals MVP over Tatum, and it helped stave off that Mavericks run in the third quarter.
Those blocks were incredible. Like, the amount of ground he covered on one of those plays where I think he got two in there, like, and that was just such a pivotal point of the game, Chris, to jumpstart that 14-0 run. They needed it right then more than ever. And so he was the one who jumpstarted that run. And I think as we just entire playoff run right now, like, I think he's probably been the more consistent player than Tatum night in and night out at this point. And that, you know, ranked true again in game one.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think he's been their most consistent player. We can certainly debate, you know, best. You look at Tatum's numbers and the attention he draws. That's legit. So that's a debate. Probably goes to Tatum. But I think most consistent goes to Brown.
All right, you want to continue to weigh in on game one? Some thoughts. How about Joe Mazzulla? You know, a lot has been made about, that timeout. Whew, I mean, the breathless discussion of that timeout when the Mavs got within 8 after Luka hits that 3. The timeout that had Celtics fans basically.
The timeout heard around the world, Jim.
Oh, yeah, let's touch on that and how overrated it was. Next, here in the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Stay tuned for more of the Sports Hub Celtics Show. Everything basketball.
It's a 3. Got it. Pull up 3. Tatum blocks the shot from behind, and the heat is on.
The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Like many, many nights we have seen in this building this year, when the Celtics were able to turn their offense up to a level that even the best defense in the NBA over the last 2 months could not handle. For 10 days, it's been Kyrie Irving and Luka Doncic. Luka Doncic and Kyrie Irving. But there's two ends to the floor, and the Celtics exploited all of the minutes that both Dallas superstars were on the floor. And the Boston Celtics, with their 77th win of the year, are now 3 wins shy of the ultimate goal. Game one of the NBA Finals is history, and it wasn't close. Boston 107, Dallas 89. The Celtics lead the NBA Finals 1-0.
Celtics again up 1-0 on the Dallas Mavericks. 107-89 is your final. Game 2 tomorrow night at TD Garden. And a lot of Celtics fans, including some of my friends, like Joe's on it. Joe's a factor. He's been better. Like, I don't want to crap on him too much, Joe Mazzulla, but I think many of you made way, way too much about, the Mavs get within 8. Big 3 by Luka. Joe bangs the timeout. Wow, what a great timeout. Yeah, what an important timeout by Mazzulla. A year ago, he would have waited till the Celtics were down 3 before calling it. And that might be true. So, all right, he did the right thing. He did what anyone with a pulse watching at that point would have done. Any coach
worth of salt would have done. Like, let's not make too much out of it. I think anyone would have done that. Even, like, the suckiest coaches in the league. They get close. They're going on a run. Let's bang the timeout and let's try to right ourselves. And they did after that. But, like, let's not talk about it like it's the greatest timeout ever taken by the Celtics in their history.
I understand where you're coming from. I would just say I think it shows growth by Joe. He's had a great playoffs. He outcoached J.B. Bickerstaff, who basically got J.B. Bickerstaff fired. You can argue Donovan Mitchell did.
Mm.
But he was totally outcoached J.B. Bickerstaff. He outcoached Rick Carlisle, who's one of the better coaches in the league and has a ring from his time in Dallas. He totally outcoached him. I thought in the Eastern Conference Finals, that play he drew up to get Jaylen look in game one, even in the last game, coming back with his starters a little earlier just to put the nail in the coffin on Indiana. And I look at it and I feel like that's a timeout that Joe Mazzulla last year would not have called. He would have been in the Phil Jackson Zen master. You know, there's no proof that timeouts, you know, look at the analytics. There's no proofs that timeouts mean anything or turn the tide. He would have been said, figure it out yourself. Nope. He gave you the conventional coaching, bang the timeout, let the guys reset and resettle, gave him some words of advice. They came out and played better. So just the fact that he was willing to bang that timeout there, I give him credit for, because that shows growth. It shows he's changed. My biggest concern going to the playoffs with him is, does he want to get it right or does he want to prove himself right? You know, and that's one where he got it right. That's, as you said, most coaches would take the timeout there. You're right. But he's not most coaches, and he took that timeout, and it was the right thing to do, and I'm going to give him credit for it.
So, but you just approached it and talked about it in the most normal way possible. Joe's grown. If I heard that from some of my dumb buddies that were like,
oh,
Joe's grown, like, good on him there.
Yeah, good on Joe.
Rather than, let me rub the microphone all over my, what a timeout. I've never seen such a timeout. It was that. It's like, he's grown. Like, yeah, that you want to say that.
Yeah,
Joe's grown. Like, again, last year, he wouldn't have done that. Probably not. Great. Let's leave it at that. Joe. Oh, the timeout was so hot. Okay, it's a bit much, guys.
It's a little uncomfortable. Yeah. Sure.
Chuck in Brighton, you want to weigh in on this?
Oh, my God. Thank God I'm on right now because, you know, I love you guys. You're my favorite duo on the Hub. I love calling in, how you let us all talk, the callers. But, man, Sir Christopher Gasper, the white knight in service of his new analytics robot overlord. I mean, I'll admit, like, I'm incredibly biased because every time our AI-generated coach opens his mouth, I want to punch myself in the face. And I will recognize that you, Gasper, have been critical of Joe. 3 points attempts is the most important stat, Mazzulla. But you've gone way too far in the other direction defending this guy. I mean, Gasper, I heard you on Felger and Maz yesterday say how enamored you were with Mazzulla in his in-game adjustments to stop Marcus Morris in the Cavs series.
Yes.
Like, Marcus Morris? Like, are you kidding me? You know, I was painfully listening to Lifshatz on my way to work this morning, and he dropped some knowledge saying that how the roads to the finals have been the easiest of all time, that the Celtics have been a record plus 40 aggregate on the spread through the playoffs. And Gasper, you keep saying how every series, like Automaton Joe, has outcoached the other side in the series without admitting that Murray, like he just said, could coach this Celtics team to the finals. I mean, every team we've played up until now, they didn't have their best player or lost their best player by game three. You keep bringing up how the Cavs fired Bickerstaff because of how that series went. But by the end of the series, you could legitimately argue that their best players in Garland and Mobley would be our fifth and sixth best players in those series. And if Porzingis was playing, they wouldn't have cracked the top five. Like, it couldn't be any clearer that Mazzulla is merely along the ride. So here it goes. The closest thing you'll ever get to a mea culpa from me on Joe, this team is so phenomenally constructed that our head coaching deficiencies don't matter.
No.
And get the duck boats ready.
Okay. So I'll say, look, maybe I've swung the pendulum too far. I'm just trying to be fair, but I think you're being too dug in there on your take if you're not going to give him. Yes, he has the most talented team. There's no question about it. But as I just delineated before, he's made some changes. And in terms of, it's not about stopping Marcus Morris, who was, these guys are NBA players. Anybody can be on one in any given game. It was the fact that they had a game plan. They went into it. It wasn't working. The role players were keeping Cleveland in the game. He switched what they were doing in the middle of the game, which to the timeout thing, for me, is something he wouldn't have done last year, and it's something I've criticized him for. So when I criticize him for being too stubborn and unwilling to change, then he changes in a game,
that's worth
and they're successful, then I'm going to point it out because I feel like that's the fair thing to do. So it's I think it's an oversimplification to say, well, you know, oh, he stopped Marcus Morris. No, it's not about the stopping of Marcus Morris. It's about recognizing that, yes, if you look at the analytics over a large sample size, they would tell you, stick with your game plan. The Marcus Morrises of the world are not going to make these shots. You're going to, oh, if we play this game 10 times, you're going to win 9 of them. But you're in that 10th game right now that you might not win if you don't make an adjustment, if you don't change it up and recognize it in that one game. And that's where I think he's changed to recognize, like, yeah, the numbers say we should do this and we'll win 90% of the time. But now I look at it tonight and I realize we're in the other 10% and I have to do something different.
Well, if you missed it earlier, Chris actually is not going to be surprised if the Dallas evens up this series tomorrow night.
That's correct.
He's going to tell you why, along with your phone calls, coming up next, our long commercial-free segment here on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
You're listening to the 98.5 The Sports Hub Celtics Show. You're listening to the 98.5 The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Well, Jaylen's the best player, so just looking at what he does defensively, he picked up Luka full court, he got to the free throw line, he did everything, and that's what, you know, your best player does. You know, just understanding, you know, he plays both sides, defense and offense, at a high rate, and he's been doing that the whole playoffs. I mean, when you talk about the Eastern Conference MVP, and it seems like he, you know, he's continued to pick up where he left off, and so he's playing at a high rate. We just got to be a little bit more physical with him, and again, we got to keep him off the free throw line and out of the paint, because again, he was finishing at a high rate or he was getting fouled and getting to the free throw line.
Thanks, Jason.
Jason Kidd, Mavs head coach, saying Jaylen Brown, best player on the Celtics. Chris, your thoughts?
Ooh, a little Jason on Jason crime there, huh?
Yeah.
Jason Kidd with a little crime on Jason Tatum. Here's my thought. I think this is a mind game by Jason Kidd. If anybody knows about what you do to break up a team with stars, it's Jason Kidd. Because he was on that famous Mavericks team that had Jamal Mashburn, Jimmy Jackson, and obviously Jason Kidd that was broken up by Tony Braxton. So I think that he's just trying to get in the Celtics' heads. But
yeah, maybe.
I don't, you know, on a serious note, I don't disagree with him in terms of if you're talking about the playoff run. Like, Tatum's their best player. But if you want to say during this playoff run that Brown's the best player, you can certainly make that case.
B-Rub?
It's trying to cause a rift. I respect it. I respect it right now. You want to make Tatum. Tatum was a very, very willing passer in game one, and now he sees this, like, oh, man, do I need to assert myself a little bit more? This is like
mind games.
It's mind games. That's how I take this. And this, like, kid, this is what he's done, whether it's coaching or during his career. He's been one who likes to play mind games to almost a bad degree of his own teams, but now he's clearly trying to do it with the other team now.
That's really good by B-Rob. I hadn't thought of, I mean, obviously you think, oh, he's trying to create a rift, but no, he's specifically trying to get Jason Tatum to play a certain way in game two that will benefit the Mavs, which is to force it. And he feels like, oh, if Tatum forces it and doesn't involve the other guys, we have a better chance. And I'll be honest, if I were a kid, take the mind games out of this, what they were doing defensively against Tatum in game one, I wouldn't play that way. I would play Tatum straight up and be like, drop 50 on us. Do it. Drop 50 on us. We're not going to give up open looks and get the other guys engaged. I would take more of a page out of the Celtics book on Luka and force Tatum to be more of a shooter and say, go ahead, do it. Drop 40 or 50 on us. And if you can do that and still have 11 rebounds and 8 or 9 assists, then we'll just tip our cap to you.
All right, so those that might have missed it earlier, you said you might like the Mavericks to actually even this thing up tomorrow night. Why?
I'm sorry, I just got a text that was pretty funny. Somebody saying they will not tolerate any Tony Braxton which is pretty funny. I like the Mavericks in this one for a couple of reasons. One, again, the Celtics, I think there's still a little bit of a tendency to let down. They played so well, and the Mavericks played so poorly in game one. I think that sort of evens out. Both teams come a little bit back to the mean, back to the pack a little bit. I think you'll see a desperate Dallas team that will make some adjustments. I don't think Kyrie Irving will play that poorly, and I think their role players will knock down some of the open looks that they had in game one. And I also think that maybe you're not going to get 20 points again from Porzingis. And you might have some Celtics, you know, the Celtics maybe are due a little bit for one of those games where the three-pointers for whatever reason aren't going and they keep shooting them anyway. Also, Dallas has won every game two they've played. And as I stated to start this off, the Celtics only have two losses in the postseason, and both of them happen in game twos after wins at home in game one.
Who needs to play more off that bench or any role players that needs to pop? Maxi Kleber, 19 minutes. He was a minus 15 in this last game. Lively, 18 minutes, a minus 15. Gafford, 14 minutes, a minus 10. Who's going to pop for them?
Hardy.
Yeah.
He can score, and they need scoring. You know, they played him a little bit early, but he only ended up with playing 10 minutes and 41 seconds, and like a lot of that was the last 4 minutes in garbage time. He's not going to help him on defense, but if it's going to be what it is in game one and you need guys to knock down shots, I think he gives them a better chance of knocking down some of those shots. They need a better game from P.J. Washington, and I think they really need a better game from Lively. He only took one shot attempt. He's a better passer than he showed in game one. He's a guy that can do some Robert Williams-esque things passing the basketball, but he got in trouble with fouls. He had the five fouls. He had multiple turnovers, including that stupid travel. He seemed to emotionally get knocked off his game.
Lights
Lively
too bright
has to be
for
better
him.
For them.
The lights felt too bright for him.
Yeah,
this was too big of a moment.
I agree.
For
so
Lively
he has to be
game.
Better. So Lively has to be better. PJ Washington has to be better. And I think they have to play Jaden Hardy more.
Jim, I loved your comparison yesterday about Lively's.
Oh, the promotional blow up guy outside the used car dealership. That's what he was, just kind of flailing around. It's either that or a girl that stinks of patchouli that's at a fish show. Oh, look at all the colors, bro. Like, ugh. Yeah, he was not great in this game.
Well, it's the thing is, in this series now, it's like you have to guard everyone wherever they are right. In the floor. You don't get to hang out by the basket with like Rudy Gobert anymore, or even Josh Kidd, whoever they would throw him on the last couple of series, and now we saw him exposed a little bit on that front.
Hey, that's a great point, because we had on the Boston Globe Today sports show, we had Mike Curtis, the Mavs beat writer for the Dallas Morning News on, and he made a great point echoing what you're saying, B-Rob, which basically is like the Mavericks haven't really had to deal with this. You know, Chet Holmgren a little bit can step out in the OKC series, but really they had Zubaz and then Rudy Gobert. They haven't had to really deal with bigs that can stretch the floor the way the Celtics bigs can.
Tony in Manchester with a thought on Jason Tatum. What's up, Tony?
Hey, what's going on, guys? So I called in first hour yesterday afternoon, and just a little bit, I wanted to challenge you a little bit, Jim, on your opinion on Tatum's performance yesterday. You were just mentioning a few other guys' plus-minuses, but, you know, all the other things that have been said, the rebounding was great. He was moving it around. He was letting the people that were hot be hot. And he had second-best plus-minus in the game with 19. Drew Holiday at 20.
How do you feel about the six turnovers? Because you strike me as someone if Brown had six turnovers, you wouldn't be able to see any of the other stats in the box score other than the six turnovers.
Yeah, I mean, I got to give it up to you. It's a good point on the six turnovers. But I think in totality, playing 42 minutes and the way he was able to play team ball and not – try to get overly aggressive and not try to make it his game. I just think that's what they need to do.
No, Tony, and I
agree with that last part. Yeah. That's a great point, Tony.
And I gave credit to the rebounding, too. The turnovers were atrocious. And also, and like, he even admitted after the game, like, there were some nerves there.
Oh, yeah, it's true.
I hated hearing that. Like, this is your second time there.
Can I ask you a question? Because you're really good at this. I feel like you're really good at reading people. Like, if you weren't doing this, I feel like you could have been a psychologist.
Yeah.
So, like, you always were right with saying, you know, when David Price said, like, the duck thing, you're like, oh,
the water off the duck's back. Yeah.
You know, you're churning underneath the water and all that. Did you get some of those, you know, duck vibes from Tatum?
In that
press conference.
Oh, not so much of the press conference. I mean, actually, I think it's healthy that he admitted that.
Okay.
I hated hearing it because, again, it's not your first time there. I would think you'd be a little bit more seasoned, you know, and if it's Luka saying that after game one, it's first time to the finals for him. And I know he had a lot of success in Europe early on in his career or whatever, so maybe he's, you know, not as shook by it. But I like that he admitted it on one hand because I think that that's the mature thing to do, but I hated hearing it, like, as fan because it's like, dude, you've been there before. What the hell are you nervous
about?
But
were you buying that? Because this is the part that I don't buy. When he sounded to me a little like Kyrie when he tried to spin it as a positive. He's like, it's not, like, really nervous. It's more like first day of school, like nervous excitement.
Yeah.
I was like,
yeah,
no.
I don't buy that.
Okay.
Yeah, that part I did not buy. No, okay. Not for a second. All right. Well, we'll continue to take your calls on the Celtics. We get ready for game two between the Celtics and Mavericks, tipping off tomorrow night at 8 p.m. We'll get right back to your calls. How about that? Right after the headlines here on 98.5 of Sports Hub.
Gasper and Murray have scorching hot takes. Twisting your mind with Pat Celtics and Bays. They'll also talk soft and out-of-town things. Just call them up on this Saturday. Gasper.
Hey, Murray.
Gasper.
Hey, Murray.
Just call them up on this Saturday. Gasper.
Hey, Murray.
Gasper.
Hey, Murray.
Gasper.
Hey, Murray.
Gasper and Murray, 98.5, the Sports Hub. I just want to pivot for a minute here and get your thoughts on something, Chris, because it's lighting up the internet.
BackstageCountry.com, your online home for all things country music. Today, having a great music video can really help push a song to the top of the charts. We choose our favorite six of the best country music videos. From Reba to Hardy, go back in country music history and deep dive each of the videos. Text VIDEO to 45911 to see who made our list at BackstageCountry.com. Text VIDEO to 45911 to get a link to the list sent right to your phone from BackstageCountry.com.